Hello, welcome to BJA Today, and I'm BJ. My guest today is a fascinating young woman who is an author. She is the author of this book, Uprooted Heart, The Journey Back Home. It's a great book, a quick read, but it's an intense story. I want to welcome MJ Nixon. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
You know, MJ, we've had a great time laughing and joking about I'm BJ and you're MJ. I came first and you came second, and I'm sure somewhere in God's atmosphere we're separated at birth.
Yes, and we share the J.
And we share the J's. But you know, one of the things that really got me about you is that you are just one of the most transparent women I've met in a while. It's nice to meet someone who just really doesn't care about what people are going to think. Mm-hmm. And throughout the pages of your book, it demonstrates your true heart. But when you get a chance to simply talk to you, to talk about your journey, it says the journey back home. Mm-hmm. So where was home and where did you end up? Mm-hmm. What's this book all about?
Yes, well, this book is about my journey from death to life, from bondage to freedom. Really a place where I didn't even realize, you know, I was in bondage, just living in the world, living for me. And I got met with a radical love and a radical grace. And so the book it goes through that journey from being young until now and just everything I've learned from this moment.
You know, there's a lot of things we go through, especially as young women, mm-hmm. that I don't think, you know, I always say this to my brothers and even my husband, that guys didn't go through the stuff that we go through as young women. Mm-hmm. There's differences, but I guess there's similarities too. Mm-hmm. There's a journey that you went through that a lot of young people are going through right now that mm-hmm. they don't say it to their parents. They don't yeah. say it to many people. They really don't want to say it to themselves when this journey of pain begins. Mm-hmm. But then there's the moment of truth. Mm-hmm. Talk to us about the painful years, mm-hmm. what you've walked out of, and how in the world did you do it?
Well, I grew up in a very traditional home. I grew up with, you don't express your emotions. You just hold things in. And I was the middle of two brothers. So growing up, I started to really get involved with the things that the boys did. I really started to take on a lot of the attributes of my brothers because that's all I knew. And so growing up, having these attractions and having these thoughts and not understanding, you know, being very young and already knowing, wait, I'm attracted to the little girls and not the little boys, and knowing that there was something wrong with that, but not really feeling like I had a place to share because of the traditional background I grew up in.
Right.
I was told that this was wrong, so I didn't have an outlet to share.
So is it that you didn't want to share it, you couldn't have shared it with your brothers, or did you really, were you able to let yourself know that this is what you were going through? You know, there's that place where something is so painful, so different, so wait a minute, what is this? Mm-hmm. And you don't see anybody around you going through this.
Exactly.
You don't know.
Mm-hmm. And I really didn't know until really high school. And as we were talking about now, I really believe, you know, it's reaching children so young, just desensitizing the children to, no, it's okay to have a relationship with the same gender. But when I was growing up, it was something that people were very, as you say, closeted.
Yes.
You know, it wasn't talked about.
Right.
So I had never really experienced or seen anybody really living out that lifestyle until I came to high school and people were more open and they were more out in their sexuality. So
as you enter high school, there's a whole sundry of things we experience mm-hmm. coming from our middle school age to our high school. You walk in the door and you want everyone to know you. And it seems that this is your opportunity to step out to a world that you've never stepped in before. Mm-hmm. What was the open door that allowed you the opportunity mm-hmm. to experiment in an area that you should have never been able to get into?
Mm-hmm. And what I realized in hindsight in those years is that the word says that life or death is in the power of the tongue, and we eat its fruit. And when I was in high school, there was an openly bisexual male, And for the first time, all those things that were hidden in my heart, I spoke. And when I spoke, it really got a grip over my life. And then I named myself. I gave myself that label that I am gay. And then it just really took root in my heart.
You know, people don't think that your tongue is that powerful. Mm. But that, as you use the term label, it labels you. Mm-hmm. And then you begin to, what you heard yourself say, you begin to believe and act on. Mm-hmm. So
exactly.
Then you press yourself into something that was never really meant for you in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
Where was that point after you began to say, I'm gay, that you realized you had reached a place that you had to hide it from your brothers, your mom, your dad, and you couldn't really reveal all of this yet?
Mm-hmm. Well, I always had felt the conviction from understanding through the Word that this was not what God had for me. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't until I received that relationship with the Lord that I really saw it for myself. So growing up, I was always hidden. I always felt that shame. I always felt that guilt to not even share with anyone. Even when I was in a relationship with a female, we acted as if we were friends. We didn't want to share with anybody. We didn't want to bring it into the light because there was a lot of shame there for both of us and a lot of conviction. It was never condemnation because Jesus didn't come to condemn the world.
Right.
He came to save the world, and he came to save me. And I'm so grateful for the Holy Spirit and his just conviction on my life. But as it came to my family and what I knew that they knew, I couldn't. You know, I couldn't share with them. I didn't expect them, if I got married, to be at my wedding, to be perfectly honest, because I knew what they believed.
There's a place that we want to get to that's, we've just hit the top of this, but mm-hmm. we want to go a little deeper.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to go a little bit deeper in just a moment. So you just sit back and relax, because we'll be right back with more of this story. It's somebody else's story, but just know, at the end of it, it's all right. Everything's going to work out.
Every day across America, excess food is gathered by a network of good people at local food banks, giving hope to millions of children who struggle with hunger. They've earned their wings, and you can too. Together, we can solve child hunger. Support Feeding America and your local food bank at feedingamerica.org.
I mean, any time that you're looking for another person to fulfill your identity,
right.
you're in the wrong.
Right.
No one's going to be able to ever fulfill what you can only receive from Jesus.
Right.
He's the only one that can fill that place. And we
right.
can try, and we can try, and we can try to fill it with people, things, materials, our performance. You know, our job, but nothing will ever fulfill that place. And if people are truly honest, they'll say, you know, that's true.
Right.
That is true.
We're back with MJ Nixon. She is the author of Uprooted Heart, and we were really into the journey that God has her on and where she is right now. But we moved right out of high school, and we're about to enter college.
Mm-hmm.
What happens when now you know that parents are not looking?
Exactly.
Your brothers don't know what you're doing. You know, the people that you grew up in essence can't really see what you're hiding.
Mm-hmm.
Where do you go? What do you do? What was the next step?
Well, college is freedom.
Yeah.
And freedom to make a lot of decisions and make a lot of choices. And so for me, speaking out, now having that name label, that identity, making my sexuality my identity, it was free, you know, free. And I played college basketball, and I met a female, and I just had a pull. You know, I had an attraction there that I hadn't had before. And I just started getting closer to her and forming a friendship with her. And through different just times being together, spending that time together and making that emotional soul tie with her and being tied to her, it led to cross over that line physically.
As that began to happen, did you ever pull yourself back and say, no, I just can't do this?
Mm-hmm. There were times I would be strong and there were times she would be strong, but at this point in my life, I really had not surrendered my life over to Jesus to really lead my life in a place of purity. So there was still that place where I was allowing for my flesh to reign and go after what my flesh wanted.
There's someone out there who's saying, wait a minute, it's almost sounding too simple. Mm-hmm. I know that I'm going through this pain. Mm-hmm. And what she's saying is, I hadn't surrendered. But isn't the whole thought of surrendering a difficult thought within itself? Then you've got to surrender you. And then the very thing that you've pent up for so long because society has said it's so bad. Mm-hmm. So speak to that.
Well, and I think, you know, we want it to be Jesus incorporated. We want Jesus when it's good for us. And the thing I always tell people is I did not want to surrender my sexual identity to Jesus. I wanted to have control of that place. And I know it's very real feelings. I know it was a very real attraction. I know when you get emotionally tied to somebody and physically tied to somebody, even science says you become connected.
Yes.
And so I know that place of what people are going through when they're really connected to somebody. But I will say that God came in and he brought that conviction and he showed me his love and his mercy when I really wasn't looking for him, when I was in rebellion. And I love that the word says that right now, wherever you're at, he knows you.
Yes.
And he's not going to leave you and he's not going to forsake you. And I just want to say to people that he doesn't hate you. He doesn't. He doesn't judge you. He loves you. And that's a father's love. And a father will do whatever it takes to reach his children.
As you went through this place of understanding that you had this sincere attraction to this woman and that you all were in a relationship. Mm-hmm. What was the point that you said, no, I want to receive my true love?
Mm-hmm. I realized that, first of all, I was making a person an idol. I was expecting for this woman to fulfill longings that only Jesus could in my heart. So at the deepest part of me, being honest with myself, I realized though I was going after this and there was momentary pleasures in it, that I wasn't fully satisfied in this relationship. And I just felt this tug on my heart and this tug on my heart and this tug on my heart, this gentle voice that said, MJ, this is not the purpose, the plan I have for you. There's such a greater destiny for your life than just living for yourself and living to please and save others. I had a savior complex. I wanted to save these women.
Yourself.
Mm-hmm. 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 And no person can ever fulfill. You know, we expect so much out of people, and then they fail us, and then we are hurt. And that's just not any relationship that's counterfeit. You know, if we're trying to go in and be their savior, we're not their savior.
You know, you say with any relationship, have you ever, at that point, had you ever had a relationship with a man? Had you ever been involved with a young boy in your high school years up to your college years?
Here and there, but it was more to get people off of my back who were questioning my sexuality. So it was more of a cover-up. Again, I was feeling that conviction and I was feeling that shame. This is not who I am. So I would get involved in relationships because of that.
Wow. Mm-hmm. So at the point of, we're now at the point where you begin to have a heart change.
Mm-hmm.
The uprooting of the heart begins.
Yes.
And that's where the thickness of this story really begins.
Mm-hmm.
We'll be back in a moment.
Take a look under your bed. Find stuff under there? What about jobs? No? Now try your closet. Still no jobs, just more stuff? Well, you really have both. See, stuff is defined as household articles considered as a group. Sometimes this stuff is no longer needed. Wait, no longer needed? That can't be right. Because remember those jobs you were looking for? Those are really needed. And they're the stuff inside your stuff. Our job is to unlock those jobs. And it starts when you donate your stuff to your local Goodwill. Here's how we do it. When you donate to Goodwill, we sell your stuff to provide job training for people right here in your community. So just by teaming up with Goodwill, you help create jobs. And isn't that worth parting with the leftover keytar from your 80s cover band? Goodwill.
Donate stuff. Create jobs.
A soul. And I said, okay, Lord.
So you didn't know it was her church?
I didn't know it was her church at all. And she was the one running the event.
Get out.
Polly was the one running the event.
The women's ministry.
And when I went in there, Polly wouldn't pay attention to me at all. And I was like, okay, this lady's got a lot going on.
And I said, Polly, you got to come and meet this girl.
And so afterwards, for some reason, I'll open up to anybody. I'm not ashamed. But for some reason, it's not normally the first thing I lead with. But for some reason, I'm like, okay, Lord, I'm supposed to meet somebody here. So I'm going to wait for this lady because I really believe it's this lady. And I waited. And I said to her, you know, I used to struggle in homosexuality. God's freed me from that lifestyle.
Hello.
That's awesome.
And I'm MJ. I used to struggle with
it. And she goes, and they freak out. I'm like, normally I don't get like this type of like reaction. She goes, you will not believe this. My pastor is on like his fifth week of a sermon series on homosexuality.
Stop it.
Wow.
And
it's what the Bible says about homosexuality. It's excellent.
And it was phenomenal. Yeah, I went that next.
And so it was a Saturday night, and I said, you need to come. Tomorrow is the last session of his message. Mm-hmm. You've got to come. Mm-hmm. And she goes, okay.
Wow.
So she came, sat
with
beside me. Yeah. And afterward, what did you think of the way he did
it? Oh, it was phenomenal. He gave me some books. I was like, thank you. Yeah, this is great.
We're back with MJ Nixon. And I know many of you are saying to yourselves, this is where I'm at. This is what I'm going through. These are the struggles. But here we have real answers. And MJ, thank you again for your transparency. Mm-hmm. We were talking about the college years and mm-hmm. moving through that point where, okay, the heart is actually being uprooted.
Yes.
Uprooted heart.
Yes. So God gave me a vision of my heart, and he led me to Matthew 15:13, and it says that any plant that the Father has not planted would be uprooted. So I saw my heart in the weeds of this deception, in the lies about who I was, and he uprooted me, and he planted me in his garden. And he planted me in his truth, because the word says that his love is what leads us to repentance.
Yes.
So his mm-hmm. love in my life led me to the place where I was at. But his truth is what sets me free. And really the truth of the word truly set me free to truly know that I'm no longer a slave to sin, but I'm a daughter of righteousness.
What amazed me when I looked at the cover of this book, I thought, wow, this is such a great cover. Mm-hmm. It's simple words, but there's a strength, there's a power, there's an intricacy in just the graphic design of it. Mm-hmm. There's a story even here with the cover of the book itself. Mm-hmm. As you were going through that point where you were ready to put pen to paper, mm-hmm. you had to step back in your memory and say, okay, these are the things that I went through.
Yes.
This is the person that I was with.
Yes.
These are the lies that I told. These are the places that I hid. Mm-hmm. But certainly, it wasn't just you and the relationship. There was someone else. Mm-hmm. How did you handle that breakup? I've been through breakups, mm-hmm. but nothing like what you've been through.
Yes.
How did you handle that? And what happened to mm-hmm. the other lady?
Well, especially because I was so hidden, you know, even severing that and walking away from that, that was all done under the wraps. No one really knew, but what was great is Jesus knew, and he was there when I was going through the deepest pain. And what I love is I always share this. It's one of the things that has touched me the most is Genesis 50:20 that says, you meant to hurt me, but God used your evil for good to save the lives of many people, which is being done. And I realized that relationship had to be severed, had to be walked away from. You know, that was no longer who I was, because when you become born again and you become a new creation, there's something that changes. And because you love God and you want to please him, your desires are no longer for that tie to the person. Your desires are, God, I love you because you first loved me, and I want to please you, and I want to do your will. And no longer do I want to live for myself, because when I wanted to live for myself, I was connected with this woman. But as I wanted to live for God and that became who I was, mm-hmm. I decided, though it was very difficult, Philippians says to leave your past in your past and focus all your energy on your future. And so I had to go through some trauma, yes. I had to go through some pain, yes. But every step of the way, as I said, God, I choose you today. God, I surrender to you today. Lord, I lay down my own will to you today. God just came in, and it's just about receiving it. It's a free gift, and I started to receive who I was. I started to receive fear of the Lord in my decisions and every circumstance, and it just led me closer and closer to truly who I was as a daughter of the Most High God.
As you begin to relax in that and breathe that you're the daughter of the Most High God, He loves you like that. Mm-hmm. He forgave you a long time ago. In fact, He doesn't even think about that person that was, that just is gone. You've received His forgiveness. There's a world around you, people who knew you then mm-hmm. and people who know you now. Mm-hmm. How do you maneuver, live, move to be able to love on someone who doesn't understand how you were able to walk away? Mm-hmm. What do you say? How do you move so that they might receive this joyous life that you now have,
Amen.
This sure mm-hmm. life that you now have?
Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, just people in my own life who knew me, there was a lot of forgiveness, you know, and there's so much humility in saying, I was wrong. I hurt you. What I did was not okay. And I had to go back to a lot of people in my life. And I think that showed them Jesus. Just the ability to say, I'm humbling myself right now, and I'm saying, forgive me. Let it go. And that helped me, you know, to let go and to move on with other people. Mm-hmm. And when I sit before a person, I see them how Jesus saw them. Jesus didn't see them all messy in their sin. He saw them for who they are, and He extended His love to them. And I'm just so grateful for that, and I pray that I'm a representation of that everywhere I go, that as we were talking about, it's not about what we do, it's who we've become
yes.
and whose we are. Mm-hmm. And so I just be who I am in Him, and then He is the one, as He is exalted, that draws all mankind unto Himself, just as He was drawing me. In those times where I was far away, I love the story of the prodigal son. I mean, a radical grace that this man did not deserve, but his father cared so much and ran towards him and embraced him. And that's what God wants to do for all of us. And it's just there. He's there. And all we have to do is receive that.
There's so much to this. There's so many parts that it's just impossible to cover. All. But we're going to try our best to give everyone exactly what they need. Mm-hmm. And I think you said it best when you titled this book, or when God titled it for you.
Amen.
Uprooted Heart. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
It's
Thank you.
Just good stuff. It's just good stuff to be on the other side of it. Mm-hmm. And we thank you. I'm BJ Arnett. This is BJA Today.
The inherent right to work is one of the elemental privileges of a free people. Endowed, as our nation is, with abundant physical resources, and inspired, as it should be, with the high purpose to make those resources and opportunities available for the enjoyment of all. We approach this problem of re-employment with the real hope of finding a better answer than we have now.
And then last Friday, I actually got to speak to their youth group, so that was amazing.
That was cool.
And yeah, that was great. I love what they do. They have the teenagers text in questions, so not somebody standing up.
So it's anonymous.
And so I really like that. And just got to share with them my heart about it, and I love
that
talking
to the
youth.
So were the texts raw?
They didn't have as many kids, I think, as they wanted to have, because of course you have that conversation and not a lot of them want to show up.
Yeah.
So I think they were expecting more kids.
Yeah, they were.
And some of the parents were there, so
that
was, they didn't want the parents there, but some people showed up, so they actually had a lot more questions than the kids.
Welcome to BJA Today, and I'm BJ Arnett, your host. My guest today is a wonderful woman who I've just become good buddies with. I'm going to tell you this story. Okay, so we were at this place, and y'all know, I say this all the time, but it's so true. Women meet in the ladies' room, and we talk about everything.
Yes, we do.
MJ Nixon is my guest today. She is the author of Uprooted Heart. Thanks so much for being here. You know, I get tickled every time I think about the fact that we're standing in the makeup mirror just talking and just getting to know each other and know what we've walked through. Mm-hmm. I love your book. It's a simple read that has a clear story and a clear end. As you have lived through such emotionally traumatizing moments with coming from a homosexual lifestyle to the love of Christ and your life today, talk to us about your life today. You have so many fantastic things that you're doing right now. But not one, but many. But the thing that sticks out to me the most is your ability to be so transparent that you are sharing your story with young people and allowing them to be healed by your testimony.
Mm-hmm. Well, I believe the best conversations happen in the bathroom. So
They do. Many divine appointments in the bathroom.
Yeah, I'm super excited with what God has done in my heart, and I just want to share that with others, especially being a part of this generation, just reaching the hearts of the youth before everything out there in the world tells them who they are, that I just get to share, you know, what God's done in my life, that grace, that mercy that He's extended to me. And I just love kids. They're so full of joy. You know, there's not that fear that we have as we come into adulthood and we have to be this or that and this, you know, schedule and this. They're just free.
And they'll say anything, which means they'll ask anything.
Yes.
They'll actually come out with, okay, well, what do I do about this? How do I handle this? I have a friend who has this. I need to know how I can help. Have you been able to help them with the words to help a friend or help themselves?
Yes, it's been amazing. And I love when I get to go, you know, and really as we were talking about, just even the church.
Yes.
You know, being open to sharing, talking about it. Let's talk about sexuality. Let's talk about sex before the world tells them that their worth comes from who they're with. Physically.
Yeah.
You know, let's reach them and having environments where children can share and ask questions. And even as we were talking about texting in the questions, being anonymous, not having to stand up with a microphone and say, I have this question. And so I really am so grateful for youth pastors who are inviting Uprooted Heart to come to their church, to come share this testimony, being transparent, because somebody has to be transparent.
You know, as you go through the news today, there's so many issues that are coming down the pike that we already know. This is an accident that is happening. It's not waiting to happen. It is happening. So now we have an atmosphere in our nation that says it's okay for a male to go into a women's restroom under this transgender situation and vice versa. What are you seeing in terms of what young people are going through that gives you red flags as to how this is going to play out and how it is actually playing out?
I realize once as a society, you open yourself up to homosexuality being a legal marriage, a legal covenant, you open yourself up to anybody saying, well, this is how I identify, and I want to be received, just as the homosexuality community is being received. Why is me loving somebody who's my family member not okay?
Well, how would that be different?
Mm-hmm. Exactly. You know, young people, you know, marrying a young person, it makes anything go. And so for me, you know, with the kids, it's just who they are. I want them to know, you know, by what I've gone through in my struggles, you know, being able to share with them what I went through and being transparent with them and just seeing that freedom to just reach them.
You know, it's one thing to talking to young people who are within the four walls of a church, or young people who are on the basketball court, or who have a strong family environment. Mm-hmm. But it's a whole nother thing to step outside of that security wall, if you will, of mm-hmm. the church, and see someone on the street who you know is struggling, mm-hmm. who you know is walking out a homosexual lifestyle. Mm-hmm. And your heart is to help them receive mm-hmm. the true and living God.
Exactly.
What has that been like for you in touching people outside of the youth and outside mm-hmm. of the church, four mm-hmm. walls, if you will, but just simply to be a minister on the street?
Yes. Well, the first thing I realize is they need Jesus. They need Jesus in their life. Even before we talk about homosexuality, because we know sin is the parent to our rebellion. That goes all the way back. And so, first of all, I want them to know that God loves them, that He's extended His hand to them, and that He wants to draw them in, because we wouldn't be having that appointment. It's not coincidence. It's not chance. Even the people who are going to watch this, it's not coincidence that they're seeing this. And so I realized that in running into them, that God already ordained that before the foundation of the world, and that He wants to touch that person. And how do I do that? Not by holding a sign and yelling in a microphone that you're a sinner and you're going to hell, because that's not what Jesus did, but it's sharing and extending my hand and saying, I see you, because He sees you, because He lives in me. And He wants them to know Him, to truly know relationship with Him. So many people know rules. So many people can spit out verses. Mm-hmm. But there's a difference when it hits your heart and He comes into your heart and He just wants that relationship with you. And there's a closeness in that. There's an intimacy in that. That really is what drives us to want to go help other people.
As you go about speaking around the country, and you are about to approach doing a great video piece that you are just all enthralled with right now, what would you say is the one thing that you want people to walk away with when they hear your story?
Mm. Want them to know that there's hope. There's no pit too deep, that God's grace is not deeper. There's no sin that is too much that God puts His hand and says, no, I don't want you. There's no one too dirty that God does not say, come here, I want to clean you up. I want to bring you near to me. There's no bondage. There's no stronghold that could ever be so strong that the love of God cannot get in there and just break the lies and break the deception.
You are such a pleasure to talk to. I thank you so much for being here.
You're welcome.
You're
thank
awesome.
You for having me. You are amazing. Thank you.
Okay, so it's a love fest now. Thank
Sister
you for
best.
Joining us. MJ, what is the heart of your book?
So it's my journey from what the Lord showed me from a young age all the way through to where I am now. And especially the one that's called The Journey Back Home, it just talks about the lust that I had and momentary pleasure versus eternal, you know, oneness with God,
right,
and my surrender of that.